Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to the Alertus webinar series. My name is Sharice Ruan, Marketing Specialist at Alertus Technologies. During this presentation, Miles Harriger, Director of Higher Education Sales, and Joseph Tuck, Sales Engineer, will provide insight on Alertus Alert Beacons and how you can use them to effectively reach everyone in your facility with audible visual notification. Feel free to submit your questions during the webinar at any time, and they will be addressed during the Q&A session at the end of this presentation. This webinar is being recorded and will be shared with you after today's session. If you have any questions after this presentation, please email marketing@alertus.com. Now I'd like to turn it over to Miles and Joe.
Thank you, Sharice. So today we'll be presenting on Alert, Attract, and Act, how the Alert Beacon captures the attention of everyone in an emergency. Let's get started. So again, for those of you who don't know me, my name is Miles Harriger. I'm the Director of Higher Education at Alertus, and I'll be presenting today with Joe Tuck, our sales engineer. For our presentation today, we'll be covering the history of Alertus. We'll be discussing the M&S codes and mandates. We've done thousands of presentations here at Alertus, and so we'll be reviewing some of the emergency notification challenges and some of the common ones that we're coming across and see which ones apply to you. As well as we'll be discussing our solution. And the main focus of our solution today will be the Alertus Alert Beacon. We'll then do a live demonstration. So we're sitting here right now in front of our demonstration room, and we'll be doing a live activation to show you what this all looks and sounds like. And then we'll open it up to you all for questions and answers. So a quick background about Alertus. We're headquartered in the Baltimore, Washington, D.C. area. And over the past 16 years, we've helped thousands of colleges, universities, corporate centers, healthcare institutions, governments, and military bases improve their protection of their faculty, staff, students, and employees. So we serve a lot of different sectors. And we work with thousands of companies. And certainly after this webinar, I'm sure we have somebody locally in your area that we can give you a reference for the Alert Beacons. So let's get started. So first, what we want to cover is what is emergency mass notification? Think of emergency mass notification kind of at the top, you know, kind of as your umbrella. And you have kind of two forms of mass notification. You have unified facility notification, which is your indoor and outdoor notification, and you have personal notification, you know, messages going directly to your, you know, phone, text, email, to yourself personally. And so under emergency mass notification, you kind of have two forms of communication, your indoor and outdoor and your personal notification. And it's important during this presentation to understand the different layers that emergency mass notification has. Now, I'm sure a lot of you on the line here are familiar with a lot of the codes and mandates and the common challenges on this slide that you're seeing in front of you. For everybody, you know, that's sitting and listening today, these code and mandates, you know, are different for everybody on the line. But I'm sure everybody here sees a couple challenges and sees a couple mandates that apply to them. And during our presentation today, we'll be covering how the Alert Beacon and some of the other Alertus solutions can help you, you know, with these challenges and mandates. And, you know, one thing that I always say is, you know, write down some of these codes and write down some of these challenges, you know, and after this webinar, you know, ask us a question around these solutions, or most importantly, during your next demonstration with Alertus, you know, talk to us about how we can help with some of these specific challenges and mandates. But the most common ones we come across with our solutions is the NFPA National Fire Protection Association, ADA, compliance with the American Disabilities Act, UL, the USC, and the Clery Act. So those are the most M&S codes and mandates that we come across. Additionally, we come across a lot of the same challenges that we're talking to with prospects and clients of ours, where they have some specific locations where there's no way to notify. Also, buildings not staffed 24/7 is something that we hear common. You know, think about your facility and your location. You know, do you have any special needs individuals there? You know, if you do, how are they getting that audible or visual message in that emergency situation? Additionally, you know, loud environments, you know, does that apply to you? Do you have specific areas that are extremely loud that you need to get an alert to? Also, cell phones not allowed. You know, we work with a lot of colleges, universities, a lot of corporations and healthcare facilities that we work with don't allow cell phones in specific areas. You know, does that apply to you? And then also visitors and contractors, you know, how are you alerting the people at your facility, at your location that maybe you weren't planned on alerting? So, you know, these are kind of the common challenges that we're coming across and the common codes and mandates that we work with our clients to comply with. And so we'll be discussing how the Alert Beacon and some of the Alertus solutions can help you with these challenges and mandates. Now, if I'd go one by one for everybody on the call today and ask, you know, how do you issue an emergency notification? Everybody here is a bit different. Some people have one step, some people have two, and some people have three. But the main point of this slide is to kind of internally walk yourself through your emergency notification process and understand how many steps does it take? Because what we're finding is most organizations, it takes up to about 30 minutes to coordinate an emergency notification. And certainly when seconds count, it's not acceptable. You know, so, you know, whether it's two steps, three steps, or four, it's one step too many. And even for, you know, a few on the line that do have one step, you know, a lot of organizations are looking to expand. And so what we'll be discussing is how we're going to keep that as a simplified solution, as a one-button solution as you kind of have it now. You know, what we're going to be focusing a lot today is on how we can help you improve audible and visual notification at your facilities. You know, the importance of both means are very important for any organization that we work with. And we'll be discussing from an audible perspective of, you know, how the Alert Beacon can help, but as well as our integrations with other existing infrastructure that you have at your facilities, you know, like your VoIP phones, you know, like your speaker systems that you already have in place, like your fire panel speakers. And so there's a lot that we can do with the Alert Beacon and other integrations to help with your audible notification. And in addition, the Alert Beacon can help with visual notification as well. We also have integrations with desktop computers and digital signage and cable TV and many other platforms to help with the visual notification. But kind of the thing that separates the Alert Beacon from, you know, any other product that you'll work with is the Alert Beacon helps with both the audible and the visible notification. And we'll get to that a little bit later. And we always talk about education and engagement. You know, anyone could have the most perfect, you know, emergency notification system in the world, but if you're not educating and engaging your employees, you know, your students, your staff, and you're not training, you know, the system won't work to its best ability. So, you know, one thing I want everybody to think about on this call today as well is just the time that you spend on educating your staff and your students and your employees with emergency notification just in general. So for the Alertus solution, our first step and our focus is a single point of activation. So if you're somebody that uses Alertus right now today, or if you're somebody that has a different system in place, our focus is getting you that one button solution. And we do that by integrating with the current systems that you have there currently on campus. And our focus is a layered approach. So, you know, kind of going back to that first slide, you know, we help with indoor, we help with outdoor, and we help with personal notification. And those different layers are very and extremely important with alerting your staff, your students, you know, your employees with that information. And it's important to have a balance of both audible and visual notification. And our focus is to integrate with your current notification assets. So think about the assets that you currently have at your facilities, you know, your desktop computers, your VoIP phones, your fire panel speakers. You know, what notification assets can we help you leverage in the event of an emergency? And then even with integrating with those notification assets, there's still typically spaces and gaps and areas that are being missed. And that's where you can put the Alert Beacon and some of the Alertus hardware solutions to cover those gaps and areas. And so now you're looking at our solution overview. This kind of draws to everything that we can help with. You know, If you're interested in any other products, we can certainly get into that at another time. But today we're going to heavily focus on the Alert Beacon. And so let's get started with that. So before I dive into some of the features of the Alert Beacon, I'm going to have Joe Tuck, our sales engineer, kind of explain how the system's set up and how the Alert Beacon communicates in your environment.
Hey, thanks, Miles. So what I want to do is kind of give everyone a very high-level view of how an Alert Beacon can integrate very seamlessly into your network. The Alertus solution as a whole is a client-server solution. So with that being stated, the server is most times on-premises, and there's several reasons why we implement this type of solution. Again, at a high level, what we're doing is we're leveraging your IP network that you already have existing in your organization, and the Alert Beacon itself is simply reaching out to the server at a regular interval, usually once every 15 seconds or so. It does so via the firmware that we embed that's specific to each organization. And each organization will have their own unique Alertus server name. And so when the Alert Beacon is requesting for information, it would simply use your network's DNS for hostname resolution and contact your Alertus server. we can have deployments as small as you like, and we can scale it up to many different devices on your network.
Thanks, Joe. So, where do you put these Alert Beacons? Everybody we work with is a bit different, but most people, if you kind of go back to that challenges slide we were discussing, most organizations will put the Alert Beacons in areas that are being missed in the event of an emergency situation. Some common areas, for example, would be dead zones. It would be areas that lack audible visual notification. Again, going back to that ADA compliance, these Alert Beacons are placed indoors in any specific gaps or areas that are being missed. If an emergency alert happens, whether you're activating through your current Alertus system or you're activating through the current system that you already have, we typically have partnerships with those other systems. And so the Alert Beacon would just be another checkbox in that current interface that you already have. And so in the Alertus or your partners, our partners interface, you have checkboxes that say, text, email, social media. The Alert Beacon would just be another checkbox in that interface, so giving you that single point of activation. And additionally, if an emergency would happen, the beacon's wall-mounted, and it receives a message through PoE or Wi-Fi. I'd say most organizations install PoE. And the Alert Beacon goes off with a loud strobe, a loud sound at 106 decibels, a flashing strobe, and it displays that message on the Alert Beacon screen. So it's going to grab everybody's attention in that area to understand what that situation is. Now, some of the key features of the Alert Beacon is it's reliable. It's not dependent upon a congested or cell phone towers or the internet. Kind of going back to what Joe was just mentioning about the setup of the Alert Beacon, it's extremely reliable. It's also affordable. We talk to a lot of organizations about upgrading their fire panel speakers or installing a PA system, which can be millions of dollars. The Alert Beacon is a very, very cost-effective solution for getting that emergency information to your facilities indoors, as well as it's interoperable. So, kind of going back to our API and our partnerships, whether you're sending this alert out through Alertus or you're sending this alert out through one of our partners, this Alert Beacon can integrate with your current system. And I think that's a big thing that separates Alertus and the Alert Beacon, from these other organizations that are out there. Our goal of our system is not to change your plan, it's to help you improve it. And the Alert Beacon can be a great device to really help you improve your audible and visual notification. So that interoperable bullet there is a really important piece of the Alert Beacon. And additionally, it integrates with other existing systems. So Alertus can supply you with the Alertus LED marquee. And so if you think about some areas like a cafeteria or an area like a main lobby or a large, you know, auditorium, you know, maybe you want an LED tied to that alert beacon so people can see that message from a very far distance. And so the alert beacon can tie into other Alertus products like the alert beacon. It also can tie into the Alertus HPSA high power speaker array system. So I'm not sure if you all joined for last month's webinar on the Alertus HPSA system, but we can tie into our HPSA system as well. And the alert beacon is kind of the product that controls that communication. It also controls that communication to maybe some other solutions that you already have there at your facilities. And that could be, for example, fire panel speakers. The alert beacon and our text-to-speech module are the two devices that tie the speaker system to your current interface as that true kind of one-button solution. It also integrates with internal or external PA systems as well. And so the alert beacon sits by itself, but it's also the device that communicates to all other the other pieces of hardware that you have at your facility and locations. And also, it's zonable. You know, so we work with organizations that have, you know, multiple locations. You know, maybe you just want an alert going to one of your seven locations. Additionally, we work with high rises in New York where they have multiple floors, and maybe you want an alert just going to a specific floor, or maybe you want an alert just going to one specific beacon. The Alertus system gives you that customization, and it gives you the ability to zone your alerts. And so it's a great product to do that. Additionally, Sharice mentioned to me that we're getting a lot of questions. Keep them coming. After this webinar, we're going to get around to answering as many of those as we can, but I just got a tap on the shoulder that we're getting a lot of questions, so keep them coming. The National Fire Alarm Signaling Code. So I'm not sure if you all are familiar with NFPA 72, but it's essentially the code for fire protection. And essentially, the Alertus Alert Beacon is in the NFPA 72 handbook. And it states that where audible notification is provided, mass notification systems shall also provide visible information to serve the hearing impaired and for high noise areas. And so kind of going back to what I was just discussing about our integration with fire panel speakers, the Alert Beacon is the product that the kind of the glue that ties those two systems that you have separately together. And so, you know, a lot of institutions and organizations that we work with, whether it's sending information out through the fire panel speakers, or it's from a fire station pool internally communicating that information of where that fire pool came from, the alert beacon is the device that communicates between those two systems. And so, you know, as of recent, we've been getting a lot of inquiries about our fire panel integration. The alert beacon is the product that communicates between those two systems. So Joe's going to do a quick overview of the specs and dimensions of the alert beacon. And so I'll pass the mic over to Joe.
Hey, guys. So as you can see on the slide displayed to you now, the alert beacon has a really good form factor. It's approximately 7 inches by 6 inches, and is not much larger than a traditional fire pole. A lot of times you'll see these co-located together. So just to kind of give you an indication of the size of the way this looks on the wall, the picture that you see underneath is actually one of our enclosures in the event that you would have an event to where you would want to install this outdoors. That is a heated enclosure and also keeps it separate from the weather. So for the LED display, there are eight separate LED patterns that you can choose from depending on your alert. You can also have the ability to choose between a red LED display or a green LED display. Usually the most popular option for the green LED displays are for things that aren't as urgent, or maybe you're trying to convey an all clear message, or even a test scenario. We have a couple of different variations of the tones. You can actually customize those, the amount of time between the tones you can set, You can set the level of the volume of the tones depending on the severity of the alert. So as you can see, 106 being the max. And you can also have the ability, if you are creating an alert, some environments, you may have a sensitivity to sound, or maybe there's some other auxiliary sound that you want to use during that time. You have the ability to not send a sound if you want. So as Miles kind of addressed earlier, our most popular way to connect to the network is PoE. You don't necessarily have to have PoE. You can use a standard Ethernet drop in your network if your network does not support PoE, and you can have a separate power source from that. For the alert beacon, we're using a 12 to 24 volt AC-DC converter if you require that. There's also the ability, if you have a FM transmitter in your facility, lots of college campuses have FM transmitters. We have the ability to connect to the alert beacons via FM. Now, this is only a broadcast message, and in these events, you would not be able to gather any health and status from the alert beacon in that particular configuration. We also have 802.11, and we have the ability, if you have a paging system on your network, and what I mean by paging, I mean like the traditional alphanumeric pager that lots of hospitals integrate, and you would have to have your own paging service for that. So that's something a little bit extra. So for security, normally we communicate with the alert beacon using either ports 80 or ports 443 on your network, and we are using AES 256 encryption. And so I covered the power. So let's move forward. This is kind of a front display enlarged for detail. We have as you can see on the front, we have the LED high intensity strobes. We have the sounder in the middle, and that's where the sound for your tone will come from. The LCD display, we can display up to 480 characters scrolling. And then you have the ability to have your own proprietary security screws to mount that on the wall. On the back, you'll see that we apply a unit ID. That's essentially a MAC address for that. Standard MAC address. We have the power switch, how to turn it on and off, reset button for the device. So we also have the ability to have rechargeable batteries. So if the unit is charged or is powered via PoE or through an external AC-DC converter, the rechargeable batteries will extend the period of the alert. So if during an alert scenario, if you lose power and there is a emergency situation ongoing, that unit will continue to display. We recommend that you use nickel metal hydride batteries for that, which we also provide. So we also have the ability for some of our auxiliary connectors. As you can see, it's that green part of the back of the alert beacon. That gives us the ability to power some very low voltage devices. Also, we have two auxiliary inputs and two auxiliary outputs. These are dry relay contacts. So if you wanted to connect, whether it's a panic button or some other activation device, or for the outputs, if you had some devices that you wanted to activate, like some LED strobes or sirens. As you can see, there's a serial port for connecting to our text-to-speech or our LED marquees. That's using a DB9 connector with the RS-232 protocol. And there's a small port, as you can see, it's kind of a little square area where we integrate our Wi-Fi radio chip.
Thank you, Joe.
Yep.
So let's do a quick system activation to show you what this all looks and sounds like. So right now I am logging into the Alertus console. Going to pick the situation of an intruder lockdown. Click continue and send the alert out. So that was a activation of the Alertus system, and you know, understand that you know, with these alerts, everything can be customized. You know, so you can color code your messages. So an example, you could do a red desktop takeover and a red flashing strobe with the alert beacons, and then match it with you know maybe an all clear message once the situation been taken care of with a green flashing pattern from the alert beacon and a green, you know, desktop override. So these alerts can be very, very customizable. You know, as Joe was mentioning about some of the features of the alert beacon, you know, if you have a situation where you have alert beacons in the hallways and it's a situation where, you know, maybe you don't want to draw them out to the hall, but if they do go out in the hall, you want them to understand an emergency is currently taking place. You could do a silent alert where there is no sound because you don't want to draw them out, but there is a flashing strobe to display the message if they go out into the hallway. And so, you know, whatever situation that you want to be set up for, the alert beacon and the alert solution can really customize to your needs. And here's a quick map. You know, I think this kind of gives everybody here an understanding of, you know, where to place the alert beacons. You know, as you can see with, you know, A and I, you know, labeled with the alert beacons, you know, it kind of gives you a nice little visual of what it would look indoors. You know, we have a lot of organizations, you know, if you're certainly larger and you're not really sure, you know, where to put these alert beacons, we do professional site surveys where we come out on campus or to your facility or location. And we actually do a walk around of your organization and strategically design an alert beacon map for you. If you're smaller or, you know, if you want to do it at no cost, the sales representative that you're working with, you send us your floor plans. And we get together with our, you know, sales engineer like Joe and our team, and we design an alert beacon map for you for coverage, just so you can understand, you know, how many alert beacons it would take to, you know, effectively cover your organization. And so this map was to give you a visual, but it's also to understand we do have on-site professional services, and we do have free services where we can lend to you to place and put together an alert beacon map. Excuse me. Now we want to open it up to you all for questions and answers. Now, Charisse has a long list of questions. We'll get around to as many as we can. But we'll start answering your questions.
All right. Thank you both. We are now beginning the Q&A session of our presentation. If you have a question, please submit them through the chat or question box. Please note if we do not get to your question during this session, a representative will reach out to you to answer your question directly. A recording of this webinar will also be shared with you after today's presentation. Now let's begin with our first question. Is it necessary to use the alert beacon with the TTS modules?
No, it's not required and it's not necessary. The TTS, or for those that are not familiar, the text-to-speech module is just that. It is a module and it's optional and you can add it on. It's helpful in the event that you want to integrate with you know, other systems like PA, or if you do not have a PA system, you can integrate some of our own self-amplified modules.
Yeah, and to touch on that, Joe, most organizations just have the alert beacons indoors themselves. Just the beacon by itself gets you that coverage. But there's some organizations we work with where they do want that speech component, and that's where you can buy the Alertus indoor self-amplified speakers or tie to existing fire panel or PA systems indoors as well.
Okay. How does the alert beacon interface with a voice fire alarm system?
Okay, this is a great segue for what we were just speaking to. So if your fire alarm control panel has the ability to input analog line in, 1 volt peak to peak, what we would do is we would have a plan to where we would have an alert beacon that would reside close to the fire alarm panel. And we would have, from that alert beacon, we would have a text-to-speech module. From that text-to-speech module, the output of that is the analog line out. So that's the most, I would say, the simplest integration that we have.
Okay. Can the alert beacons be used as pull stations as well?
So the alert beacon on its own does not have any way to initiate an alert. What we would recommend in that situation is to integrate one of our hardwired panic buttons. So in that case, the hardware panic button would become the trigger for an alert. And once that alert gets sent to the Alertus server, it's up to the organization on how that message will get disseminated. You can create groups in your organization. So if you want to have maybe potentially a group for faculty and staff, maybe another group for students, maybe a group for operations or HR, that's all customizable and up to you. But alternatively, you could create a trigger to where it sends to all devices.
Thank you. Do the alert beacons have an anti-tamper function so no one can pull them off a wall without an alert?
Yeah, sure. So we briefly kind of touched that before. When we install alert beacons, the organization chooses a security screw of choice. And as far as determining whether or not someone has tampered with an alert beacon, let's say hypothetically someone were to just vandalize it and rip it off the wall, you know, hopefully that would never happen in your organization. But if it does, what happens is that the alert beacon routinely checks in with the Alertus server, and it gives it a system health, whether or not, it has an IP, if it does have batteries in it, what the voltage of the battery charge is and things like that. So in the event that alert beacon gets tampered with, you're going to get that notification in your server under the reports. Also, you have the ability in the Alertus server to set that to where if you get any errors regarding alert beacons or desktop notifications or any of your other Alertus connected devices, you can have an email sent to your IT support team or administration.
Yeah, and to add to that, it's typically not a problem with vandalism. We really don't come across it a lot. We do have a wire guard that you can purchase in addition to the alert beacon as well to protect it. It doesn't really affect the sound or the visual. It's a pretty good way to protect the alert beacon. So if that is a concern for you, you can also additionally purchase our wire guards. We're relatively very, very inexpensive.
Thank you. How many panic buttons can you connect to a beacon?
Oh, that's a great question. So on the back of the panic button, there are a total of four dry contact relays. Two are for input and two are for output. So specifically for the alert beacon in mind, you can connect two hardwired panic buttons to it as input. If you require more, we do offer the ability to connect more hardwired panic buttons up to our IP relay. So that's also an option. So we can get up to 16 per relay.
Does Alertus offer a cloud solution for the server to reside in?
So the Alertus server itself, it runs natively on a Microsoft server platform. We would require it be a 64-bit compiled OS, meaning that it be Microsoft 2008 R2 or newer. It's designed to be an on-prem solution, but as an organization, if you do have some cloud-hosted resources that you would like to install this, as long as that cloud-hosted resource meets our minimum resource requirements for your solution and your integration, and it also has the Microsoft server necessary, you can install that on your cloud instance. Just make sure that that your alert beacons, when you install them in your network or your desktop, your Alertus desktop notification clients, are WAN accessible so that they can access that cloud instance.
Okay, thank you. Can the beacon receive an alert if it is on a lower floor of an underground parking garage, for example, by the elevator?
Yeah, sure. So that really depends on how you have the alert beacon connected to the network. If it's connected via just a PoE drop from your switch, of course, you know, if it's connected to a wireless access point, that's really going to depend on the type of RF propagation that you have in your facility. So if you're putting a Wi-Fi enabled beacon in a basement, if it has connectivity to an access point, it'll receive that signal as well. So the answer is yes.
Okay. Can you hook up more than one power source to the alert beacon, such as DC and PoE, together at the same time?
Where it's not highly recommended that you do so, we recommend that you choose one or the other. It does have the ability to be powered by either or, PoE or the external AC or DC power, additionally with the temporary battery backup.
Okay, thank you. What is the typical amount of time to get the system implemented?
It's a great question. So there's a lot of variables in there, and it really depends on the size and scope of your implementation, the size of your current IT infrastructure. So, you know, obviously with smaller environments, you know, maybe a handful of beacons, they could probably be done in the matter of maybe a day or several days. Sometimes for larger organizations, it could be a phased effort that may take several weeks to several months.
Is there a female voice option for the text-to-speech?
There is, actually. So we have two options for our inherent text-to-speech module. We can choose from either male or female voices. We also have the ability on the text-to-speech modules to add additional WAV files. So if there are some inherent WAV files to your organization that you would like to send, maybe to prepend a message or to postpend a message, you could do that as well.
Okay. I may butcher this question, but bear with me. Are you on standing offer with PWGSC? If not, any plans to look into this?
I would have to look into the acronym. I'm not familiar with the PWGSC. That we're going to take that as an action item and post it later.
Okay. Thank you. Is the text-to-speech bilingual?
So the text-to-speech itself today is only for English. If you require other languages, as I mentioned before, we have the ability to add WAV files, and we do that for some of our international clients. The server software itself has the ability to support Google Translate, and it's in a beta mode right now. So in the event that you have IT personnel that, you know, maybe English is their second language, we could have the ability to translate the console to other languages as well.
Thank you. We have now concluded our Q&A session of our presentation. Again, if we did not get to your question, we will directly reach out to you with an answer. If you have any questions or need additional information, please feel free to email marketing@alertus.com, and we will be happy to assist. If you are looking for more information on Alertus and our solutions, visit our website at www.alertus.com. If you are interested in upcoming webinars, please visit alertus.com/webinars to see the full schedule. Thank you for joining today's webinar, and we look forward to meeting you again soon.